Right, so there you go. So you've seen the kind of internals of the machine and its basic operation. The next thing I'm going to show you is the actual physical wiring for the keyboard, just so you have a closer look at where it goes, because that is what I initially started looking at when I was trying to troubleshoot this issue with the keys, right? So I'm going to explain in the video kind of where it goes to and what have you. And then we're going to come back once you've seen that and then actually look at the wiring diagram and the logic of how, well, I say how it works. I walk away from this thinking I had a reasonable understanding of how it works. And I say from the work this morning that I did this morning, some of that gets blown out the window, but we'll discuss that at the end of the video. So let's have a look at that. Right. So before we get into the weeds, let me just show you some bits and pieces. This is where my problem existed, which caught me, I say, for a year. This is the keyboard and display unit. We can see the wiring that comes out here. The wiring has specific colors. So you've got like white with a band of orange or a band of red, or you've got brown, or you've got violet. So it's all color-coded, and it's color-coded in the menu. The problem I had, as I kind of noted, was that all the number keys were operational, but the P, for most popular, your index or in-out buttons, as they are noted in the menu, weren't operational, and the R for reset. So that obviously initially led me to believe that perhaps there was a dry solder joint, and the actual manual is very good at going through your troubleshooting options. I'll pull up some of them. We can see the back of the keys here. So when they make contact, you obviously get a short between these two points over here. We can see some of the tracks. So I obviously thought, well, perhaps there's a common wire, which there is, but I had a misunderstanding of how this works. I just thought it was a dumb system where you make a connection and that connection is fed back to the computer and it reads it. It's far more complicated than that, but as I said, that's what we're going to go into in a little while. But there is a common wire. I first of all got my multimeter and I checked these solder joints. You'll see everything is clean on here. I have another unit. I found another unit on eBay, so I unplugged these wires and I plugged it into that. You'll see the unit I have in fact has a little bodge on it, so these obviously can go wrong with use over time. The wires come out here, they go into a loom, as I noted. That loom comes up. Some of the wires go into this Q-Rack interface. I have another spare one of those because I thought logically that's where the problem must be sitting. I checked the wire, and obviously the manual says this as well, check the wiring loom. So I checked from that point to the keyboard, the single wire or the return wire. You'll learn more about that in a moment. That was operational. So unplugged all of this. I plugged it into the unit that I got off eBay. Nothing worked. From here, obviously, the wiring then goes to the central control computer into one of these plugs over here. Well, I think it splits up. But obviously, the central control computer can read it. There is a keyboard buffer. We're going to go into more detail about that. And I thought then my issue, unfortunately, was probably that I might need to find another central control computer. And that could be a challenge. It does have an EEPROM, so it's got an EEPROM which obviously stores your settings, the audit reports and what have you. You can do a factory reset. So logically, perhaps my next course of action would have been to do a factory reset, but without those keys being read, I couldn't get into the menu system and execute a factory reset. So it would have meant either perhaps changing the EEPROM. There is a method where you can get it to reread it, but that I might not have been able to do that, or finding a secondhand CCC, central control computer. And in some cases, you might have to buy a whole unit, let's say one that's going for parts, just to get this. So that's the challenge with these units, is maintaining them, obviously, when parts might be a little hard to find. But that wasn't the problem. I say we're going to go into detail. But now at least you've got a lay of the land of where everything is. So when we start looking at the diagrams, you'll have an understanding of how it hangs together.
Right then. So now it's time to get into the weeds. And as I say, I'm going to kind of go through my initial high-level troubleshooting. Then once I actually resolved the problem and I kind of wanted a better understanding of how the logic worked so that I could do this video, how I thought the logic worked, and then again how some of that has certainly been undone since my testing this morning. So we sit with the problem that the four keys on that keypad or keyboard weren't responding. Nothing was responding on the actual jukebox. So the buttons that control the direction of the title pages, called the in and the out, they weren't operating. The P or popular, most popular button, and then the reset button. So my initial thought was perhaps there is a solder joint or something like that which needs to be checked. There's a broken track or something. Perhaps a common line to all, because it's just all those keys at the bottom, there might be a common line to those keys, which of course now I know there is. I want to highlight the one interesting thing you'll see, which I didn't note in that video, which I've seen since reviewing that video, is that although I say that keyboard looks clean, on closer inspection and with the video footage I took, it looks like someone has actually used a soldering iron on some of the solder joints on the top keys. They don't look factory. They haven't flowed, or they don't look like the initial factory flow. And in fact, the soldering or the reflow doesn't look that good, to tell you the truth, now that I've had a look at it on the video. But nonetheless, I checked all that. So the first thing I did was I got my multimeter and I checked, first of all, when you pushed each key, was it making a short or contact across the 2 points where it soldered in, and the switch of each key was operational. I then kind of had a look at the wiring. I made sure I traced where that wire came out, the common wire to all of those, the common track, which obviously leads to a wiring loom. I checked that on the PCB. I then had to stick a small thin piece of wire in there so I could get a contact with my multimeter, and I traced the loom up to the initial keyboard controller. I checked there. I then thought that perhaps there was a fault in that controller, because when I sorted that out, I thought, hang on, keyboard interface, there might be an issue. So that was my first port of call, was finding one of those. Well, in fact, my first port of call was, I think I found another keyboard on eBay, and even that was an issue because it was being sold with a whole title mechanism, the display mechanism, and I eventually negotiated. It took quite a while. I kind of gave up, and eventually I think the guy came back to me and said yes, he was willing to separate the two items and sell the keyboard separately, because I think he wanted $250 for both, and eventually I think I got it for $100. Expensive, because sometimes you can find them for $10 or $20, right? But if they're not there at the time you want them, you're stuck paying the price which is being asked. So I think I paid $100 for another keyboard, because I initially thought perhaps there's some logic in the keyboard that's faulty. I plugged that in, it didn't work. My next thing was that keyboard interface. I found one, I think it was relatively cheap. Got that, unplugged all the plugs, plugged that in. Also, it didn't work. Now, when I say didn't work, everything worked, but it didn't fix the problem. And I think in the video I might have said it didn't work. The replacement unit that I had worked, but it didn't fix the problem. So at that point in time, now I went and checked all the wiring, and I think even up to the master computer, although I did that recently. That was almost a year ago. That's happened over the course of a year, trying to source these parts and having to walk away and go, I just don't know. And then I say, just over a week ago, I then started looking at this again. And then I thought to myself, right, let's go back to basics. Let's see what the service manual says. And the service manual has really helpful troubleshooting for many issues on these jukeboxes. And the one certainly says about, you know, keys not working, or if only certain keys are working. And in fact, it talks about that the in and out, as I recall, specifically the in and out, the title control keys, and it says if they if those don't work, have a look at the title control in and out switches. Now, as it happens, this manual, as I've mentioned, is for another model. It's not quite the exactly the same model. And I've had a look for these physical switches. So potentially you're supposed to be able to control the title pages flipping back and forth with a set of switches. And I don't think my model has them. I've looked for them. I cannot find them. But of course, the logic there is that if you get the switches to work, then it's more likely that it's an issue on the keyboard, because if the switches are working, that shows that the wiring is all working back to the central computer and the central computer is working. But I didn't have that option to test that. But it then explained that, you know, obviously check connectors, check the wiring loom, because if your switches aren't working and the keyboard isn't working, then it's either the wiring loom, physical connectors aren't making proper contact. It goes through and actually says this, which is refreshing to see that you've got a proper service manual. And the next port of call is the CCC, the central control computer. And of course there I'm like, so this is a week ago, and I'm looking at this and I'm like, oh my goodness, okay, so I'm gonna have to try and find one of these. But then something registered in my head. I was looking at this unit, the title page units, the mechanics of the title page unit in particular, and I was looking at it, and I was looking at one of the micro switches, and something had kind of registered in my head that I'd read in the service manual, and that led me to try something which ultimately fixed the problem. But now, before we get to that, let me go into and show you the actual wiring for everything and the logic control and how I thought it hung together. Right, so just to show you, this is the original optics, or the CD playing unit, which I had to remove. You've got that metal case, and then you've got the optics with the motor. So I replaced that whole unit. That was the first fault that happened. Quite common, the actual laser unit stops working. I did try and clean the lens and what have you, the optics, but that didn't work. You need to be quite careful, because when cleaning these, any static or what have you can cause immediate damage or damage over time. You can, if you have any static discharge or what have you, it could be a few months or a little way down the line that things go awry. The next unit I bought was this keyboard and display unit. You can see this is the back end where the actual physical keys push on. You've got the LCD over here. And then if we look at the back of it, you can see here, I'll just point out the bodge. You can see on this one over here, at some point in time, it looks like there was an issue with a track. So someone's had to do some solder work on this one. And for the most part, this has the display unit. And for the most part, a fairly straightforward unit that I was just able to plug in, and it worked, but it didn't solve the problem. And here is the keyboard interface. And again, a fairly dumb unit. If you look at the tracks on the back, literally, it's just a straight hitch to another connector. One connector in, another connector out, up to the central computer. There is one IC on this unit. And that IC, which is stuck, I wonder if I can get a shot of it. It is sitting just underneath over there. That is the IC that controls the motor for the title display. And literally, that also worked, but it didn't solve my problem. So now we'll go deeper into the weeds to understand the working of the keyboard unit and the intelligence behind it. Right then, so as I explain this to you, I'm going to look at the wiring diagram from the PDF on my phone rather than drag you to my PC and just point, and then I'll kind of highlight with inserts what I'm talking about. Right, so I'm going to pull up this whole wiring diagram, and in that wiring diagram, you're going to see on the right-hand side, all the connectors go into connectors into the central control computer. You can see where all the actual strobe lines are going into P15. So this was the first thing that caught my eye, was I was tracing back from the keyboard, and I'll show you where the keyboard is, and you can see all the keys there from 0 to 9. You've got MP, which is most played, reset, out and in. And you can see the wiring, they clearly label the color of the wiring. You'll have a W/B, that's probably white with a black stripe. And then you've got like B/yellow, perhaps black with a yellow stripe. So it's all clearly labeled, and that actually, for the most part, matches up in the unit that I've got as well. But I suddenly realized from looking at this that there is a lot more than simply an electrical contact that is made and the central computer reads it. Because you, as you can see, you've got this thing with this whole P15 connector, you've got strobe 1 to 10. Now exactly, in fact, there is strobe 0 to 10. I'll point that out. So strobe 0 is down below. You can see the coin switches. So you've got certain micro switches where you, when you insert either a 5, 10, 25 or 50 US cent coin, it'll drop down through a gate and obviously flick a micro switch, and that is being strobed with 0 and has a return. So I'm already getting into the operation of this, right? You've got these strobes and returns, and I certainly not come across anything like this before. I don't work with or deal with these things, particularly keyboard controllers or anything like that. So I was really out in the cold, and I started googling keyboard controller strobe. You'll see there that they've got it, they've inserted in that with the title typical, they show an electrical diagram. In fact, with a buffer, and it says strobe, and what I believe is a pull-up resistor to the 5-volt line, and then you've got the return going to a 74HC244. That is a keyboard line controller or keyboard buffer. There are, if I remember off the top of my head, 8 buffers in there, and then the 7417 is a hex, controller, or has got 6 buffers on the IC. So seeing all this, I was like looking up these words, because this strobe and everything else was confusing me, and I didn't find anything which directly explained this kind of logic of how this keyboard and computer interface worked. So I deduced, well, what's happening here? I was about to use the word obviously happening, but I say we'll see, I'm probably proved certainly a little bit wrong. I've highlighted in yellow, but you've got these strobes. And when I did research, I saw both someone saying it's a clock pulse, which is just called a strobe, or it's a strobe where literally it just means you're taking a line high, you're strobing high. So I took it as perhaps, you know, you're taking the line high, and that made sense. So if we have a look at, in particular, where my problem lay. If we go back from the keyboard, you can see that all those keys, MP, RST, in, out, the ones which were an issue, have a common line, right? And that is a strobe line. So that is a common line going to all of them. And the way the central computer is able to tell which key is pushed, because it's not using 2 sets of wires from each key to go back, because that's a lot of wiring. It's kind of almost using like, kind of like a multiplexing or matrix system to read which key is pressed. So you'll see if we go back that strobe 5 is noted as being MP, RST, out, in. That strobe line goes through what they call here the digital display, and I think here there might be a slight difference in my unit to the this physical unit, but it goes through there, and you can see it goes through the other side down, and that strobe line goes through those keys, and it'll be returned back as a return, and let's call it a return code, once the contact is made on one of those switches. And but that same return code, so in other words, for the central computer to identify which key is pressed, it needs to be a specific strobe line, in this case strobe 5, and then let's say the MP is pushed, that MP is return zero. But that return zero is for both key 0, 4, 8 MP and the limit switch. So basically it uses what I thought was a series of strobes where it stepped through. It would send us, let's say, a strobe along strobe 1, then 2, and wait for a return. Because if you remember, the return is not unique to one key. So in order for the central computer to actually understand what's going on, I thought it would have to logically strobe one of those lines, look for the return, and then strobe the next line. And it's obviously doing this fairly quickly and sequentially going through the strobes and reading the returns, and that way it can understand which keys are pressed. Now, the other thing to bear in mind is that this computer can see if two keys are pushed at the same time. It also needs to cater for debounce. Debounce is avoiding an unintentional double depress of a key. You don't want two touches of a key due to either shaky hand or a dirty contact initiating two pushes, where you don't want a double flip of the page or a double number to arise. You want some hysteresis, and that's debounce. So I thought, yeah, logically, this would actually cater for some hysteresis or debounce, and it logically steps through. And let's say you're holding two keys, like for instance, in some cases, you need to hold perhaps the MP key and then the reset key to initiate a step up through the menu or something. While you're holding that, it would see, yeah, that's being held for some time and latched, and then it would look at, as it's strobing through, that the return for the other key is being depressed. But you can have two keys being depressed which have the same return code. So I'm not sure how it caters for that logic. And what I'm going to show you here is a very simple diagram I've drawn up just to kind of show the logic of the process. So the way I kind of think or thought this work was, the central computer has to look at input output and then run a process for that I/O. You've got a keyboard input and you've got input from micro switches to control all kinds of things, where it's the location and the switching of the title page, to the magazine rotating, to the grabber arm or the plate that secures the CD on the CD player, feedback from the CD reader to know if it's operating correctly. But if we look at the case of, let's say, strobe 5. And now when I say they go from 0 to 10, I think 6 and 7 aren't used. So it's not a full 11 strobes. But let's say this is the 7417 IC. Potentially you'd have a control coming out from a central computer. It would then send a strobe out on strobe 5. And then it would know that, let's say, you push the out key. When you push that would send a return code 2 to the 74244, the 74HC244, and it would process that way. And my logic was, it would do the strobing through these. It would send a high, basically a high voltage, a 5 volt logic high through there, and if that key was pressed, that logic high comes back, and that's how it notes what's been pressed. And then it moves on to do a next strobe once it's processed what it needs to do for that key press. So my logic was, it would send the strobe, whatever strobe number, it would read the return code, it would do the processing. Now this processing could be all kinds of things, right? It could be reading the number you're inputting for the CD selection and storing that ready to make the selection. It could be reading the key that says it needs to flip a title page. So if you push the key to flip a title page, it would go through the process of reading that and then sending out strobes. There are strobes that it sends to the motor. And in terms of the logic going to the motor, again, I wrote this down thinking this is logically how it must do it. But let's say you push to go and turn a title page. It would then basically, once it, let's say, realize that you'd pushed the in or the out, it would then send out strobes on 9 and 10, which control the motor, and I'm going to come back to that, and then a strobe 1 to read this two switches, the limit switch and the index switch. So the 9 and the 10, according to the manual, what they do is, for one, they set the speed of the motor, and you can program the speed at the speed it goes to flip the title pages. So there is a separate motor controller, presumably it's a stepper motor of sorts. It'll have a setting which the IC that controls that motor tells the speed, and then the other strobe tells it which direction to go in. Now obviously the other logic it has to look at is it's going to send a strobe out, and I'll show you the logic on the circuit diagram, to go and strobe the limit switch and index switch. And the limit switch obviously tells it whether it's at the end of the run, because you don't want the motor trying to turn when it's at the end of the run and it cannot turn a title page, because it'll bind up. And basically I got it to actually do this. I'm going to go into that. I'm going to insert a little video clip here just to show you, because I only saw this morning after I did all my filming. I had to get the camera in, and I'm going to show you there's a little sled with a wedge on the belt that drives the flipping of the title pages, and that comes to and hits the micro switch to tell it there's a limit. And my logic would be that obviously it would go to, for one, say, am I at a limit? So I cannot turn in a certain direction. It would have the processing logic in the computer to do that. So if I've been told to turn in a direction where I can't because I'm at a logical limit, because you can program that it cannot go all the way to title page one, you could say only start at title page 5 and end at 8 if you've only got CDs in those. So there would be some logic to have a look in its memory and say, what are my logical limits? And then am I at a physical limit, which it strobes with strobe one. So that strobe goes through and it's sending a signal through to those micro switches to tell it certain positions. And then once the motor starts turning, one of those switches is disengaged. That'll be the index switch. And on that physical wheel that I'm showing you, there are little bumps which will tell the motor when to stop, when it's reached the full flip. So it rotates until one of those bumps, little index bumps, comes around. It then pushes the index switch in, which then tells the motor and the central computer to stop initiating the motor to turn. That is how I pictured that this logic worked. So now what I'm going to do before I go into the area which has caused a lot of confusion for me, I'm going to explain how I got the unit up and running again, because then we're going to come back, I say, and look at this logic and realize this perhaps my logic is not quite correct. There's obviously this processing that happens. When you hit a key, it gets processed. It then has to have a look at the state of certain micro switches to see whether it can perform a certain action. When it's performing that action, it's waiting for a micro switch to be switched. When it's switched, it says, right, I have to stop the motor. I've completed that action. The title page has been flipped, and now I'm ready to perhaps look at other input from the keyboard. And my thinking was also that perhaps when you've actually pushed one of these buttons, is that I thought if it was sequentially strobing, or like a multiplexer going through and looking at certain inputs and then going back, that for instance, let's say the keyboard would then be disabled for that very short period that it's talking to the motor. So if it had, let's say, for instance, said, I'm not going to strobe number 5 looking at those keys while I'm driving the motor, that kind of made sense to me, because it would explain the predicament I was in. So how did I solve this? When I was looking at the device, I remember talking about this limit switch. And as I was just about to give up and think I had to find a new computer, central computer for this, I saw the little index lump pushing in the micro switch, and I thought, is that the correct position? Should it be somewhere else? And I thought, well, let me just physically move it. And as noted, if you want to flip the title pages, you can't. If you grab the title page itself, you'll break something, because there's too much torque required. You have to use this little wheel. So what I did with the machine turned off, and this is the very interesting part, with the machine turned off, and I I'm fairly certain it's a stepper motor, because when you switched on, the stepper motor has been held under high torque in position. You can't physically turn it. So with it switched off, I did a little rotation which released the micro switch, because it's now past the little index point. I then switched on the jukebox, and here's where I'm glad I noted what happened, because this behavior hasn't happened again when I try to replicate the problem. When I switched the jukebox on, it then initiated a title turn without me doing anything. And I went, oh my goodness, okay, that was good, because obviously I hadn't had this working for a year. Then I went to the keyboard and I pushed the buttons and they were operating. So all it was that fixed the problem was me physically moving the wheel to release the micro switch. Now, so that solved the problem. I thought, okay, then I looked at the logic and I've exactly what I've explained to you, and I thought, maybe it was held in a state where it hadn't perhaps finished a page turn properly, and therefore it locked out using strobe 5 so that it didn't look at those keys. That was the most logical explanation to me. However, today I tried to replicate this problem and I came across a couple of interesting things. For one, I'm going to show you a photograph. What I did, I was thought, oh, well, let me first of all take measurements, because I've taken measurements across these strobe lines, right? And for one, they don't just go high. I'm going to insert some of the captures I have from an oscilloscope, and you'll see it is sending a very interesting series of very short pulses and then a longer clock pulse, if you will. That clock pulse, if I remember off the top of my head, is somewhere between 4 or 5 milliseconds. I did some writing down of this short capture that I did yesterday, thinking that it was a normal straight pattern that it was repeating. It was going through either 5 or 6 small pulses and then a bigger pulse. And that kind of made sense to me, because if you look at the number of things that you would potentially be strobing for the keyboard, if you weren't looking at credits and doing other things, the number might logically tie up that you're now only strobing that number of strobes. And on that line, you might be seeing a very slight, small glitch pulse, if you will, before it received its proper strobe pulse. But then this morning I came back, because I only had one probe yesterday. I forgot to take 2 probes. I took a second probe today and probed 2 strobe lines at the same time. And I'll put up on the screen, their signals are in sync. So I was expecting to see that high pulse offset by 1, because I was going to the next logical strobe, and it's not the case. And everything is being strobed at the same time. So now I'm in my head, I just cannot work out the logic of how it is reading the feedback if it's strobing everything at the same time, and why there are these smaller pulses. I suppose, you know, what might be happening is if you're strobing everything at the same time, you're just holding down one key, you're just going to get a return on that key. If you're holding down 2 keys at the same time, it'll somehow logically work out that it's seeing 2 returns for an extended duration and work out that 2 keys are being held down. So since this morning, I just haven't had enough time to go through in my head and suss out what's going on. But those are the signals, which is a little different from what I was expecting. But what I tried to try and again understand what released these keys from working was I tried to recreate the problem. And while I was looking at this, I noted that, and I'll show you a picture, that the one connector on the micro switch was almost shorting out and touching another connector. And in the manual, I think they may have it round the wrong way. You'll see that the index switch and the limit switch, they say that the limit switch, I think, is in the normally closed position, and the index switch is in the normally open. And I found certainly that the index switch is in the normally closed position, and I measured the pulse is actually being passed through the switch, because you've got two connectors. You could have it so you can change normally open, normally closed position, but the pulse is being passed through that switch when nothing's happening, when the switch is being actuated and it's on the little nub. So I thought, for one, I pushed and shorted the connection to see what would happen. And what happens is, then you've permanently got the signal going through, it's not broken, and then when you push the switch, the motor doesn't stop, because now it's the switch activation, it's doing nothing, you've permanently got the signal going through, and so it continues to drive the motor because it doesn't think it's hit the reference or the index point. And the other interesting thing was, I did this to the point where the limit switch, the little shuttle, came down the belt, and I thought it would stop things, and it didn't. It actually bound up the motor, and the only way to quickly stop it, because obviously you can damage things, was I had to switch off the jukebox. And so that was interesting to me, that it wasn't also looking at the signal on the limit switch to say, ah, hang on, I've hit the limit, stop. It's almost as though perhaps when you push the button, it might initially look at the limit switch and say, am I at the limit? Yes, don't do anything. But after it's done that, it ignores that, and it's only looking at the index switch. So anyway, I went through all these permutations. I even disconnected and played with the position of the index switch to see if I could mess things up. I even, what I did, because I thought logically what might have happened was, as I pushed the title button to change a title page, I switched the jukebox off mid-operation. And here's where an interesting thing happened. What I was expecting, so I got it caught now in a position where the physical wheel, and I did this in two ways. I did it for one by switching off the device to see if the computer may get confused. When I switched it back on, nothing happened. It stayed in that middle state, but I was able to go around, and I actually had an oscilloscope looking to see if the strobe would stop activating on those keys. It didn't. It continued working. I went and pushed the key. It then just moved it and got it to the correct index point again, and everything was fine. I then switched off, physically moved it in the middle, switched back on. It didn't move. The strobe continued operating. I pushed a button and it went back to normal. So the key difference here from when I resolved the problem was that even when I got it in a mixed up state intentionally, nothing happened when I switched the device back on. But when I did this, when I had the keyboard not working, and I switched off the machine, I physically moved it past the point where the index switch was being activated, and I switched it on, it actually then completed a rotation, which is different from the behavior I saw this morning. So all I can assume with looking at everything I've seen and trying to understand the logic is that somehow it got its knickers in a knot. English term, it got confused. It somehow got caught in a mid-state where perhaps it was at the right index point, but for some reason I think it either wasn't sending or wasn't listening to the return for strobe 5. So those keys were logically knocked out. All the wiring and everything was fine. It was a logical issue in the central control computer. One that I haven't been able to replicate, but once I had actuated by physically moving and actuated that switch, when I then switched back on, it then managed to get itself out of that state just for that one process, because everything else was working, right? I could actually play one CD. The one issue was, I needed to re-index the machine because I put the new CD player or what have you in, and I couldn't do it because I didn't have the operation of the P and the R keys. And it's just this one process which obviously got locked up, but by actuating the limit switch, the index limit switch, it fired up, it corrected itself, and everything was working. So there you go. So if you do have a better understanding of a controller system like this, where you use strobes, as you can see in the circuit diagram, and wait for a return, and you understand the signals that are sent and perhaps how they are read and processed, that would be really fascinating. Perhaps you happen to be a technician who works on these systems, and you might have insight. Now, I say might have insight because this isn't explained in the manual, of course. This is very low level. As a service technician, you wouldn't need to know this kind of detail, because once you've checked the obvious things, the wiring and everything else, if you had a problem, you'd either perhaps do a factory reset of the computer if you had control of the keys, or you'd simply perhaps hook out the computer. And if you did that and it was locked up in a strange state, by replacing it or perhaps replacing the EEPROM, you would correct the issue, because now you wouldn't have the computer which had the existing confusion, we'll call it, or its nick is in a knot, as I would say. So I hope you found that video interesting. I'm certainly very chuffed that at the end of the day, even though it took a while and I bought a few bits and pieces, it was a relatively simple fix, and I have this wonderful little jukebox working again. But anyway, thanks very much for watching, and I'll catch you soon for the next one. Cheers.